In this video, we'll start studying the events that we may define at the smart device object level in the context of an online application, pointing out the aspects in which an offline app will differ from what's shown here. Applications for smart devices include two types of events: the client-side events and the server-side events. If you're experienced in the development of applications for Windows or web platform with GeneXus, then you're already familiar with the server-side events start, refresh, and load. The client-side events include the events of the system client start and back, the user events, the events associated with controls, and some others predefined by the work with pattern, as well as the events we studied when we saw navigation styles like slide.start, for example. This classification is important because we need to know where each event is executed, because, depending on that, the resources we may turn to will vary, as well as the applicable restrictions. There are also some differences regarding the grammar that we must take into account. Within these events, start, refresh, and load, we may use all the commands admitted by GeneXus. The start event will be executed just once, when the panel is opened. It will not be executed again unless we exit the object and access it again. The refresh event is executed after the start event, usually once, but it may be invoked again through the refresh command. In that case, it'll be executed more than once, and it will be the first event because start will not be executed again. The load event is the last event in the system to be executed. And when it has a base table, it'll be executed as many times as the number of records that exist on the base table. When the grid has no base table, it's executed only once. When the grid is based on an SDT, the load event is not executed. When the refresh event is invoked at the end, the load event will be triggered, if applicable. These events have no access to the device's resources, such as the camera, the GPS, and so on. Events on the client side are the application's response to user interaction. There are three types of client events: system events, user events, and control events. As opposed to the start, refresh, and load events executed fully on the server, events on the client side have access to all resources on our device. The code associated with these events is executed on the device, unless there's a need to access the server. Such as, for example, when a procedure is to be invoked, in which case, the process is always executed on the server by means of an invocation to a REST service. All of this is completely transparent for the developer. During the execution of an event on the client side, the system's events are not executed unless they're explicitly required through the refresh command. As we mentioned, these events will have a specific grammar that is different from the events on the server side. This is a topic we'll be considering in detail further ahead in another video. What can we do in an event on the client side? We can call REST services. When we call processors or data providers, they will be automatically exposed as REST services. We can use business components to recover or to update information. In this case, those business components will also be exposed as a REST service automatically. We can call any other object for smart devices, like nodes of the work with, panels, or menu for smart devices. We can use the external objects of the smart device API. We can call subroutines. And we can use the following commands: assignment of properties to controls, assignment of simple variables, uses of business component or STT variables, execution of for each line, and for each selected line in grids, use of if, else, do case, and do while blocks. Let's see some examples of events on the client side. For example, the insert event in the list is an event created by the pattern. Another event executed on the client side occurs when we tap on a grid item. This triggers an event that, even though we don't see it programmed in the events, meaning that it is implied in a predetermined way, it does have a call to the detail of that work with in display mode. If we want to, we can change it, and even then it would still be an event on the client side because it's associated with the tap on a control. In this case, the grid. All these events are client events, even when they invoke objects that must call services, or data providers, of the server to return the data or to save it. Now let's see what happens on the server side. The load event to load lines on the grid was programmed in this example so that, based on the value of the start time, it'll load a variable that will contain the start time and the AM or PM indicator as applicable. This event will be executed on the server if the object is executed online. Here we can see the layouts created by the pattern for the general section and the default events. To the left, we see the layout in view mode and in edit mode on the right. There's a total of four events. The first two, save and cancel, apply to the edit mode. And the other two, update and delete, apply to the view mode. All of these will also be client events. In objects for smart devices, we can identify two different parts. The first part, which we call the fixed part or plain part, will contain everything that's on the form and is not included in any grid. In the example we have on screen, the fixed part comprises the application bar with the insert button. If we had attributes outside the grid, they would be in the fixed part. We call the second one as grid part or variable. It comprises, in this case, the grid that contains all of the conference's data. We will always have a fixed part, and we will also have a variable part for each grid in the panel. So this part might or might not appear in our objects, depending on whether we have a grid in the object or not. In this case, we will have a grid part. For each part, fixed, and grid, GeneXus will automatically generate data providers to solve the access to date. Those data providers will be invoked with the REST protocol. We won't see them on the knowledge base because GeneXus will be in charge of generating and maintaining them. But we will be able to see which data is accessed by each of them. We'll see this in a moment. From a conceptual perspective, let's now see what happens when we execute a panel for smart devices for the first time. The client start event is executed first. It's executed only once, and, as we already saw, it runs on the device. Then a data provider is executed by means of a REST call that will solve the access to the data necessary for the fixed part, recovering all the attributes necessary. Then, with the outcome returned by the service, the start event will be executed, followed by the refresh event on the server side, and then the fixed part of the layout will be drawn. Then a second data provider, also called a REST service, will be executed. It'll solve the recovery of data required by the grid, followed by the execution of the load event. This event will be executed n times when the grid has a base table, once for every record. This is when the drawing of the layout with the grid part is concluded. The peculiarity that the screen is drawn at two different instances has some consequences, and we'll see that next. Let's see an example in GeneXus. Suppose that we want to show the number of conferences in the list of sessions. If we program the panel in the same way as we would for a web panel, we would place a variable below the grid, a total variable. Let's create it. In this variable, we'll show the total number of conferences. So, we go to the events, and the first thing we would do is initialize it in the refresh event. We then go to the refresh event, and we write total equals 0. This is how we initialize the value. In the load event, we will increase the value for each record. We said that the load event is executed n times, so it seems logical that we increase the value of the total variable here. So, let's execute the application. While it's generated, let's take a look at the navigation list. Note that for the list, we have two data providers. The first one we see is the one associated with grid 1. The name is workwithDevicesSession_session_list_grid1. This data provider accesses the session table and the room table to solve the grid data. Here, you'll be able to view the filters applied with all the corresponding conditions. The next one is the one generated for the fixed part called workwithDevicesSession_session_list. Note that this data provider is not accessing any table because we don't have any attribute in the panel participating in the fixed part, nor in the grid, or in the start or refresh events. And now we access the emulator. So now we go to sessions. Note that it's already shown us the total variable with value 0, then the grid records were loaded. And why is this the case? Here, we can see an outline of what we've done. Remembering what we saw before, when we opened the panel, the client start event was executed, and there was a call to the data provider of the fixed part, which, in our case, does not recover anything from the server. Then the start event was executed, followed by refresh, with the initialization of the total variable, and then the fixed part was drawn. Note that at that point, the value of the total variable was 0. Then the data provider associated with the grid was called, and the load event was executed. Here, we increased the value of total, but the total variable was already drawn in the layout with a value 0. Then the grid is drawn. Note that this is the reason for the problem. The order in which the various parts of the object are drawn, and not the fact that the refresh and load events are separated into two programs, two independent data providers. Now let's go back to GeneXus. Therefore, a solution to show the correct number of records is to program, inside the refresh event, one for each that will calculate that. The base table of that for each will be the table associated with the first level of the session transaction. Inside the for each, let's copy the total equals 1. Let's then comment the assignment of the load, and we'll place it inside the for each. And now we'll run the application again to see what happens. Let's now take a look at the navigation lists. The one associated with grid 1 remains the same. However, the one associated with the fixed part now accesses session to do a count, asterisk, on the table. We go to the emulator and enter sessions once again. And now, after the screen is refreshed, we have the total with the 9 records we had on the table, which is correct. Now we'll take a look at what has occurred. Client start was executed. At this point, the call was made to the data provider that solved the fixed part that recovered the result of the for each on the session table where the count was made. Then start was executed, followed by refresh, where the total variable was increased. This is optimized, and it'll have the result of the table count directly because it was returned by the data provider we saw. Then the fixed part was drawn. Note that now the value of the total variable is 9. The rest remained the same. The data provider associated with the grid was called, and the load event was executed n times. And then the grid was drawn. The system's load event does not require any special considerations, because it's similar to the load of a web panel. Because it's possible to include several grids with base table in the same layout, Just as in the case of web panels when we have more than one grid, it'll be necessary to specify which grid's load we're programming. We can do this by writing the grid name followed by .load. Here we show the example of the load to load the items from the grid of the list of the work with devices session. This event is executed on the server, so it has all the attributes of the extended table available for these to be applied. Note that there's no need for the isSessionFavorite procedure to be exposed as REST service. This is because it's invoked from the server itself. The system's refresh event, just like the load, does not require any special considerations because it's similar to the refresh of a web panel. It's also valid, similarly to the case of web panels, when we have more than one grid. That means that it will be necessary, for that case, to specify which grid's refresh we're programming by writing gridname.refresh. Similarly to the load, this event is executed on the server, so it has all the attributes of the extended table available for use. We've seen the events executed on the client side and those executed on the server side. It's important to tell them apart, because what we can program in the client events abides by a grammar that's a little more reduced than what we can do on the server. And this is something that we'll see in another video. At this point, we can say that this will not have any effects on the implementation of an offline application. This means that, in what concerns the grammar, you may program events in the same manner regardless of whether your application is online or offline. In that sense, it's transparent. In the following video, we'll continue to study the navigation and determination of the base table in objects for smart devices.